Test 1, 2. What?
I took a dime on the table and stayed up straight.
Alright. Okay, I'm broadcasting now. This might not be a good time, okay? Because people could show up.
Okay, I have to go around
the corners
and exit.
Awesome. I will jump from here. Okay, now go downstairs.
I can't see.
Just do it. Please? What are you doing?
So that girl with the big hair on American Idol?
Yeah, what happened?
She got canned? No, she made it.
Oh, no kidding.
She's horrible, though.
I know.
And the other lady that was crazy? Mm-hmm. She made it, too.
Right now I'm just editing some material that I shot in Mexico. I finally got a chance to get to this. I don't know if you can hear me. If you are a friend of mine on Facebook and you're watching this, can you just write something? Let me know if it's streaming or what. So yeah, I shot this material in Chichen Itza in Mexico, and basically it's the spring equinox. So I'm finally getting a chance to finalize this and hopefully put it up on my website and send it off to the agency. So that's what I'm working on right now. I'm just going, what you're seeing, I'm using AC-DC Pro 5. I actually use AC-DC Pro 6 most of the time, but on this particular computer, I only have 5, which I have to update. So that's what I'm working on right now. What you see is basically the images that came, the way they came out of the camera. And I'm just making just small adjustments, very, very small adjustments. Like in this case here, I could probably darken this area at the bottom. So, again, what you're seeing is the original image. And right now, I am just going to make a slight crop. And you can see there was thousands of people. Okay, so I'm just going to crop it like that. And then I'm going to just darken this grass right here, just a little bit. Okay, that's it. That's all we need. Maybe add a little sharpness. I really like this program. I mean, it's no secret that I use it. If you ever gone to my website, you'd notice that I have an endorsement deal with AC/DC. So it's really my favorite program. Now obviously these two images, the one before and this one, are very similar, and I'm just going to fix this one up too. It needs a little bit of contrast. The sky needs to be darkened just a little bit. Darken this up, crop it in a little tighter so that the umbrella is really, I mean, just simple things. I mean, you know, I've said this a thousand times. Everywhere I speak, I say the same thing over and over again. And basically, it's simple. If you don't start off with a good image, there's nothing you can do digitally to fix it. So the idea is to really focus on what you're seeing through the viewfinder. Now, for instance, this image here, obviously, I'd like to see what's on the phone a little bit better. So I'm going to make a couple of, I'm going to actually send this one to Photoshop because it's easier to do a mask. So let's see. All I'm going to do is I'm going to zoom in here, and I'm just going to create a mask at, let's see, 50%. And I'm going to just auto-adjust a little bit, see if I can get a little detail out of the Chichen Itza pyramid inside. Again, you don't want to kill it, because then it's going to look like it's radioactive. So we'll just leave it at that. The guy's phone is actually all... Now, it left a little bit of a halo that I'm not liking at all. I'm going to undo what I just did. Okay, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to create another mask. Much tighter. In this case, maybe 15%. And I'm just going to, again, highlight the screen, which ends right around here. And then I'm just going to go automatic levels there. No, nothing fancy, nothing out of control. Maybe adjust the curves just a little bit to add a little more detail. And that's it. So let me back out of that. Okay, now it's easier to see. And, of course, what this needs is a little bit of a crop because, as you can see, the shadow of the guy's hat, it's a fine line because if I go in and I chop this out, I'm going to lose the whole purpose of the photos, which is the hands. So let's see. What I'm going to do is I'm going to save this. Oops. I'm going to save this, and then I'm going back to AC/DC, and then I'm going to make the crop there. So let me get out of Photoshop now. So I'm back to AC/DC Pro. So here's my image, and then I'm going to hit develop, and then I'm just going to see what I can come up with to leave my proportion, which I love. So if I go like this, okay, it definitely brings the photo together, and it's not killing it. I see that Todd Pacheco is watching. Hey, Todd. How's it going, man? If you have any questions, feel free to ask me on Facebook or GTalk or whatever. Let's see. Anybody else? All right. So, again, simple things. If you're looking at what I'm doing, I'm not. If you don't start with a good image, you might as well forget it. Like, here's a good one. Now, if you look closely, those are dust balls right there from the sensor when I shot these photos. And you can see I selected two photos, one, two. And while I like the first one, I think I'm going to go with the second one just because of the dust isn't there because of the difference in aperture that I used. But let's keep going. It's all right. Now that's a cool shot. Now this guy was aiming his face towards the sun. It was really interesting. I mean, let me crop this a little tighter here. Oops. Again, there's a lot of dust happening in the sensor, as you can see. And while this is a hard one for me to really feel. Yeah, I like it like that. I mean, obviously with the dust, you can see a dust ball right here where I have my cursor. You can easily rectify that in Photoshop. I mean, I'd rather not. But so I'm going to leave it like this. There probably was, I don't know, thousands of people. Look, here you go. This will give you an idea how many people were there. So this is looking north. This is looking southbound. There was a lot of people there. Now, I do have a couple of photos here that I had. Here's the same guy. So I had this photo here. I actually sent this to the AP while I was in Mexico. When I shot this, I sent this to the Associated Press, and they ended up using this photograph. A lot of publications used this photograph because of the apocalypse that we ended up never getting. So this was like, I sent this photo and this photo right here. So both of these photos were really got a lot of use because of the apocalypse that supposedly was to happen in December. So, well, luckily we didn't get the apocalypse, but nevertheless. So basically, what I'm doing, those were the only two photos that I had basically finalized because I did those on site. This other material is exactly like it came out of the camera. So basically, you're seeing what I shot. And I'm making the edits right now. I'm just typing a little message to Todd here. Again, I only use two cameras, basically. Two cameras with two lenses, no bags, no nothing. And there's a lot of reasons for that. And one of them, if you don't continuously remove lenses and you leave them, you're less likely to get these ugly dust balls that I have in a lot of these frames. And I might have to go in and fix that. But I really, really hate using the stamp tool. So a lot of times, unless it's like a really tight dust ball, I'll just let it go. Like this photo could use a little bit of a tightening up here. This guy is dancing.
I know that the resolution of what you guys are seeing is not necessarily, you know, as tight as looking at that what I'm seeing here, but in this photo, basically there's a lot of motion in the frame itself, and the only thing that's actually still is the guy. So I kind of shot it in the opposite of what you would normally do to showcase motion. Basically, I focused on stopping the guy and let everything else go out of whack. And you can't really, you might not be able to really pick it up on your side, but that's what I was hoping for when I shot it. Just little edits. This shot I took at night. These people were all juiced up. This was actually the night before the actual event. So I, the tourists or whatever, they're all there, and then they had like the laser light show. So I shot this photo, and this was pitch black, man. This was totally pitch black. And let me tell you what I shot this photo at. Handheld, okay? So if you see here, I don't know if you can read it. 1/15th of a second, f/2.8, ISO 3200. I shot this with a 5D Mark II, as you can see here, with a 70-200 lens. So this is handheld. No tripod, and it's very, very tight. I don't know if you can see how tight it is right there. So, again, you don't need flashes. You don't need anything. You just need to see what the heck is going on and make the best of it. Now, obviously, the Canon 5D Mark II has really, really good resolution. I mean, I shot this one, again, handheld. Let's see what I shot this one at. ISO 32, 1/8 of a second handheld. With a 16-35-2.8. There's a cool shot. Now you can tell that the tourists over here, they're completely oblivious to how much work it takes to for all the the little shops and all the, and this guy right here, you can tell he has a little bit of a mind, descendants, and he's getting his wares ready. This was very early in the morning. I actually, just did whatever, and I got kicked out of a couple of sites, but I already had the photos anyhow, but anyway. So yeah, I'm just reviewing my photos to put a gallery together. Unbelievably, I hadn't really had a chance to go through my work and now I went out there with Evan Albright, who's an author, and he was doing a book. And by the way, I don't know if you know anything about what the equinox is, but basically the equinox, the summer, the spring equinox, creates this. I don't know if you can see my mouse here. It creates the ridge of the snake. So the shadow from the step pyramid creates these, like the ridge of the... Well, I'm going to show you something here. Hold on a second. See, there you go. Hey, what's going on? That's my daughter back there. She's watching Daddy, and now she's going to run away. So let me go back to the screen. She wants to kill me now. But that's all right. So everybody gathers, because this only happens at the spring and the winter. Solstice or the equinox. So this happens, and basically it leads down to this snakehead here. Now obviously what I'm more interested in is basically the people. So I'm pretty happy with this particular group of stuff. Now let's see. I also shot a lot of material in these small villages. Basically this was in the Yucatan Peninsula. So Cancun is obviously the most famous city in the Yucatan, but the only thing I did in Cancun was fly in. Let's see. So now I'm going to try to call up some other material. Hold on a second here. I'm going to see, because I haven't even really looked at any of the material that I shot in the towns. So, hold on a second, guys. Okay, so let me see if I can call up some of the material that I shot in the small villages. Okay. Nope, that's the wrong Mexico. Hold on a second. All right, some of my drives are winding up over here. So I was in Mexico for 4 days. So again, I shot a lot of material. I just got to go through and find stuff that I'm liking, you know. That's a cool shot. Obviously, it needs to, the background needs to be darkened a little bit. But what I was more interested in is not this. I was more interested in the towns. See, like, I shot this in the place is called Merida. So this is basically just everything I shot. I haven't even had a chance to pick anything. So here's a really cool shot. Haven't really had a chance. So what I'll do is I'll go through the material. This is, again, everything I shot. Again, if you have any questions, feel free to hit me up on either Google Plus or Facebook or whatever. I don't know if you can, I don't think you can chat from YouTube, so I don't know, but I'm sure you can get a hold of me if you really want. So yeah, so I haven't really had a chance to look at this material. So what I usually do is I'll go through and I'll pick the photos. So like, for instance, I'm not really decided on which one I like the best, so I'll tag this one and I'll tag this one of this particular lady. Now these two guys walking in the back is an even better shot, so I might tag more than one, you see. Okay, hold on, I just got an email or something. Okay, hold on, I got a from a fellow photographer here. So let me, hold on a second, guys. I'm kind of like limbo over here. Let me, limbo over here. Hold on 1 second. And I'll hook it all up. I just got to respond to this email. Bear with me. So, right, okay, so back to this. So what I'll do is I'll go through the set of photographs, and I really like this photograph, and the reason I really like this is because there's a lot happening in this particular photo. These two gentlemen here walking out of the church really creates a balance between the woman who's enjoying her ice cream, the church, the color, and these vectors of the towers that are coming straight down where these gentlemen are and where she is. So I'm really, really, really liking this photograph. And what I'll do is I'll probably just, let me just edit this. It doesn't need any cropping at all. It just needs to, the sky needs to be darkened just a little bit. And with AC/DC, it's really, really easy. You just hit the lighting key, and basically I'm just going to drag down the sky, and you're going to notice that it's going to get darker without any masks or any complicated anything. I mean, I really detest complication because, again, it goes back to everything I've been talking about, and that is, if the image is good to begin with, you really shouldn't have to spend more than a couple of minutes just finalizing the image, making sure it's maybe you need a little sharpening. Well, let's look at this. She's very sharp, as you can tell. Let me look at her ice cream there. I might just add a little tiny bit of sharpening. Again, AC/DC, man, this is like way easier. This is a good reason I use this. I'll go back to tune. And let's say I want to brighten these two guys right here. I just go to lighting, advanced lighting, and then I'll drag this guy up like that. And that's pretty much it. Or let's say I wanted to highlight the door. And that's pretty much it. I like the way the photo looks. Let's see. And I know some folks are sharing this, and I really appreciate this. So, like this photograph here, I'm happy with it. So what I'll do is I'll say done, and then I'll save it. and I'll leave it in the same folder, and then I'll just create a complete. So in essence, there'll be two images. The original, which of course AC/DC does as well. So if I ever want to go back, I can go back on this particular image. So let's see. But the reason I do that is because now by simply clicking up, I can go back to where I started and not have to go back and forth and so on. So where was I? Okay, so here I was. So let me just browse through some of the other stuff. Like, for instance, this photo, right? No, Todd, no glass filter for sun. So like this photo here, never going to use this, right? Obviously, I shot this one first, which was what I was looking for. These things happen very fast. You can barely tell that this woman and her kid, she put the hand on the statue. Okay, so I wish I had reacted quicker. These are moments that happen really quickly. So if I go to this one, I'm just going to delete this photo. I'm just never going to use it. So again, you can see the progression of what I was thinking. For instance, this is the first shot I took of this particular cross outside this church. You can see that I noticed this branch or whatever this is. So if you notice, the next photo, there's no branch. So I'm trying to squeeze and create the tightest frame. And the reason I was shooting from this vantage point is because, if I recall, there was a fence right there. So it was really hard to make the cross look like a cross. So, again, I went to the front. And, like, for instance, here's a shot that I took simply to have a reference point of what it is that I was looking at when I returned home. Because I use Evernote for all my notes. So I'll write something on Evernote, but it's always easier to just take a photo, especially if there's a sign or something. So I just take a photo of the sign, and now it's always attached to the group of photos. So it's really easy for me to go and say, oh, this is the Iglesia San Servatio or whatever. These were all in Merida. Nothing has been deleted. So what you're seeing is exactly what I shot. Again, I wasn't there to shoot Merida in this case. I had gone to Mexico to shoot for a book. And it's basically focused around Chichen Itza. So this is just me doing my thing, which is, in this case, travel photography. Call it. I like to think of everything as documentary photography. I just want to document whatever it is, wherever it is that I am. But, you know, I like to, like, right there. You see, I mean, again, first shot I took was this, okay? You got to see, notice how my eye picks up on things as the photos go. So, obviously, I see the guy in the doorway. I see some art or something on the walls. So, the next shot, notice that I'm including the top of the arch. But I'm still waiting for something. And I'm also including the four sets of paintings here. Because if you go back, you see? So I started with that, went to this, and then there it is. You see, I mean, that's how I work. That's how my photographic mind works. I'm waiting for something that really tells a story. And in this case, it's about the space, it's about the arches, it's about the art, and it's about the subject. Now, this is definitely not as good, but this, because he's perfectly in profile, just makes the shot. See? Okay, so again, this is all in Merida. So I take this shot first, as you can tell, and then if you look really closely, you can actually see the toe of somebody walking into the frame right here. Okay, so the next shot I took, boom, I got the whole family over there. Now, the hard part, obviously, is when you're photographing something to be a real fly on the wall. And, it's weird for me to tell you that I'm standing there and there's four people who are oblivious to my existence. And that's what it's all about. It's simply to capture the event. Now, I obviously took more than once. Actually, I only took two. So, this one or this one. Now, the interesting difference between the two is the second gentleman who's looking on his phone or something. Oh, he's looking at a piece of paper. Now, oops. Todd Pacheco is asking me what lens I'm using. That's probably the easiest question of all time. I only carry two bodies, 16-35-28 on one, always, and the other one will either have the 70-200-28 L-series image stabilized or the 28-300, 35-56 L-series Canon, which is a really, really versatile lens, but I'm only going to use that if I'm outside, okay? So let's keep going here. What else did I shoot? That's a cool shot. Again, taking a shot so I know where on earth I am. Actually, I wasn't in Merida. I was in Valladolid. Oops. See, if I hadn't shot this, I could have swore to you that was photos from Merida. There it is. I mean, I want you guys to see this sequence of photographs. So I'm looking and I see two adults with a baby squeezed in and they're on a motorcycle. So I run up to the intersection and I just start shooting pics. So here's the first photo I shot. This is the second one. I wanted to focus on those people. I'm still not quite happy. This is the third. Not really happy at all with this picture. But then I'm really happy with this photo. Now all it needs is a little bit of help. So let's just fix this picture up. So basically, the first thing I'm going to do is let's adjust the highlights just a little bit, okay? Which I can do with two different tools, either the lighting. So basically, I am just darkening my highlights just a little bit, and then I'm going to tighten this photo up just a little bit, because you see this car right on the edge here, okay? So I'm going to use those two cones, and I'm going to leave everything else in there. So the two cones are going to be my, like, exclamation points. And all I'm going to do is remove that car. I'm still not 100% happy because of that shadow, so let me come in a little bit more, okay? Something like that. And it's funny because, like, little tiny things like that is what makes a great photograph. Little tiny elements on the edge. Now, still not 100% with this photo, but it's better than what I just had. So I'm going to save that. Again, AC/DC doesn't throw away your original, so it's still there. If I ever hit Control Z, it'll get me back to where I was. Okay, this woman was part of the book, and she was being interviewed when I shot her. So, actually, then this guy came in and she was talking, whatever. I'm just focusing on interaction between people. Even when I'm shooting for a book or anything, I am not posing people. That is like the dumbest thing you can do. I mean, let it happen. You get these moments that are far more interesting than a portrait of somebody. With their wish, she owns a store in Valladolid, and she was being interviewed by the author of the book, which is the reason I was there, and one of the stipulations that I had said is, I'm not going to pose anything. Yeah, okay, I'll shoot for your book, but I'm not posing anything. I'm just simply going to document. And she, it's kind of like, basically the book is about Chichen Itza, like I said, and at one point Chichen Itza, the cultural Mayan ruin was actually owned by an American guy, which is the purpose of the book. Now, she is related to the former owner, so that's why she was being interviewed. But again, I didn't pose anything. Just let it be, man. I mean, I photographed the IMF director in December at her office in Washington, D.C. And again, no posing, just let it happen, you know? And it's always far more interesting. And the key is just let it be, man. Just let it be. Have enough confidence to just let it be. Again, these were folks that were involved in the book. I just shot like I shoot any other assignment. These kids were all, again, related to the gentleman who at one point owned Chichen Itza. And I could have gone in there. I could have done portraits of them. But you know something, what I'm interested in is their natural environment. You know, let's face it. Humans, us, we define our space. And the space is just as important as anything else, because the space, in essence, defines us. So what I'm always looking to do is photograph people in their environment. Not pose, not pre-contrived, I just want to document. And like you can see, I mean, these photos are far more interesting than if I would have told her, okay, why don't you sit down and I'll get some portraits of you. And again, that's my style, but that's not obviously the only way to do it. This family, again, is very involved in the whole Chichen Itza thing. These are just the images right out of my camera, as you can tell. As you can tell right here, completely underexposed. What I do is I'll use a lot of aperture preferred, especially because you just don't know where you're going, and it could be light, it could be dark, and I'll use the exposure compensation in the back. I use Canons, obviously, and by doing that, I'm able to adapt to whatever it is. Hold on. Yeah, so Luis Miguel Souza, who's a fellow photographer from Portugal. How you doing, Luis? He's asking me, he says, have you ever happened to shoot something that you felt when shooting it that maybe that picture was probably nothing much interesting, but when you see it in the computer screen, you see it was a great shot. Yeah, sure, it happens. Because let's face it, a lot of times I'm completely focused on what it is that I'm photographing, so I'm not wasting my time looking at the back of the screen and the back of the camera to see what it is that I shot. I mean, obviously sometimes I'll peek back there to see if my exposure is correct or whatever, because I never use flash or anything, so sometimes really dark places. And yeah, you're right. Sometimes you take a photograph and you forget about it because there's a lot of things happening, and then the photograph comes back and it's like, wow, man, that was really cool. And that happens. I mean, it does happen, but I think what you always try to do is maximize every photograph. So if you notice, we were driving around, again, for those people who haven't been listening since the beginning, this is Yucatan, the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico, and I was there shooting for a book about Chichen Itza, the Mayan ruin. But that doesn't mean that's all I'm going to shoot. I think I wasted every single moment that my eyes were awake shooting whatever. In this case, I'm always fascinated by village life. So I ran into this guy, and basically what you're looking at here is he's using a pump. He's basically pumping water out of a well using this weird contraption. It was like a motorcycle tire or something. And what I'm trying to do is see, like, right there, I'm trying to time it so that I can see him between the spokes and his, but the critical point is his arm. Okay, because if his arm is hidden behind the block here, then you're obviously not going to, you know, it's just not going to convey the message. But in something like this, like, poof, I like that picture. I might experiment with the exposure compensation, just giving me a little bit less, giving me a little bit more, because I want just enough exposure on that tire so that you can see that it's a wheel of some kind. But I still want that background, those huts back here, to give you a sense of place, okay? Now, if you notice, let's look at the photos. If you look at all these photographs, the subject and the wheel are in the exact same place. So I can tell you, when I was shooting these photographs, I was very determined for a specific shot. Okay? Now I didn't even speak to him. I just started taking photographs. Now this is probably my favorite photo because you can really see what's going on. Now the only thing that's bugging me about this photo is this green wall top right. Now it's easy for me to crop it in just a little bit tighter, but I'm not sure that taking away the wall is the right thing either. So let me just see what happens if I go this way. Okay? And I think it does. I think it creates a more balanced image, because when you look at images, I'm going to darken the back here, the huts, just a little bit. So I can do that easily by just doing that. And I can darken the ground just a little bit. Okay, so there's a cool shot. Like I said, I've said this 1,000 times, and what makes a good photograph is not necessarily the subject, but everything else in the photograph. If you have all kinds of distractions popping out, it's going to kill the photo. Like, for instance, here's a good example of a little trick that I do all the time. Just take a photo. I'm never going to use this. I just want to know what it is that I'm photographing. Because a lot of times, buildings like this, I don't know what the name is. I have no idea. So maybe I can research, knowing what town I shot it in, I can go look at Google Maps and I can figure out what on earth I photographed. Never going to use this photo in 1,000 years. This is just a reference photo to discover what it is later, because a building like this has no signs, has nothing. Of course, I walked into it. So then I'm looking. But, and you can see from these photos, I'm not 100% happy because there's no humans in this. So to me, these are incredibly static photographs. But even then, I'm trying to, you can see, like, here's one photo, and then the next one, I'm trying to even out the photograph. So then I ran into these guys fixing this wheel. So right there, I really like this picture. So let me just fix this picture up a little bit. First I'm going to do is I'm going to just sharpen it a little bit. Okay, so let's see, his hands over here. So I'm going to just sharpen it a little bit. Obviously, I'm not focused on his fingers. I'm focused on his eyes up here somewhere. But when I shot this, I am trying to create enough depth of field that he's pretty tight, and these girls back here are pretty sharp in my photo. And in this case, I'm using a 16-35, and I shot this at ISO 125 f5. Okay? I really wish you guys could, write something, because I have no idea if I'm talking to nobody right now. Okay, so like in AC/DC, again, it's real easy to just darken specific areas of the image, and even to saturate specific image parts of the image. Like, let's say I wanted to saturate just the reds, which I'm not going to. I'm just going to illustrate it to show you. I could just drag the reds up, and you notice it'll saturate just that particular color. And now I'm going to bring it back down to earth like it was. Okay. So I like that. It's unbelievable that I haven't even had a chance to look at these photos. I mean, I'm rather embarrassed at the fact, you know, but sometimes you just get caught up with stuff, and you just, oh, I really like that picture. I really like this picture. Sometimes you get caught up in stuff, and you get, you know, I mean, I've been to India since I shot these, and I hadn't even looked at these yet, and, you know, I'm embarrassed, but that's the way it is, you know? I mean, thanks, Todd. Again, if anybody has any questions, and you guys are watching, are watching using Facebook or whatever, let me show you. I'm actually here. Hey, what's going on? This is this is my, let's call it a studio, whatever, my workspace up in my attic. And you can see, so like there's my screens. And there's a lot of computing power happening up here. But you guys would rather look at something else. So let me put it back where I was. Okay, so I really, really like this picture. This picture's what I was trying to get. So again, I'll just check the sharpness, add just a little weeny bit of sharpness. Okay. And let's see, maybe brighten this kid's face just a little bit. Okay, and maybe darken this wall just a little bit. Again, dude, I'm not sitting here changing the photo. If you need to spend an hour fixing a photo, you might as well just forget about the photo. That's my philosophy. What you're seeing is the way it came out of the camera, and then that's it. Obviously, you can do more stuff. In AC/DC, you can do curves and tones and whatever else, but you can look. I mean, if you take a good picture to begin with, then there's nothing else you need to do. There's a lot of things happening in this photo that I really like. This triangulation between these three subjects. The woman you can barely see, but I really, really like this photo. Again, everything you see here is exactly what I shot. There's nothing deleted here. So here's a photograph, the first one I took. I saw this girl walking, took a shot, but notice the next one. You see how much better it is? Because now my photographic mind's thinking. See? And I only took three. One, two, got it, three. She has no idea who I was, nothing. Yeah, one of these days I'm going to set up I'm actually, for you guys that are watching this, if you guys are watching this and you happen to live in the area, I spoke with the editor at the Standard Times, and it seems basically what I requested was that, hold on, I'm reading some links at the same time. Basically, what I requested is that we have a day to meet the photographers. So expect that real soon. That's going to happen soon. And I look forward to doing that. And I plan on including the other guys as well. Now, these photos that you see with this family on these cart things, I'm shooting this out of the side of a car as we're moving, because you can actually see the car in this photo right here. This, I'm not sure where I shot this. Again, this is, now you notice that my wide angle on this particular day, the photos end right here. From here on, it's stuff that I shot with a 70 to 200. You can see. You're going to see a lot of the same subjects, different look, different feel. And I really like this picture far better than anything else that I shot with a wide angle. So let's just tighten it up a little bit. Nothing too drastic, just brightening it up, adding a little contrast, and that's pretty much it. I know I got some more viewers. How you guys doing? This is material I shot in Mexico. I went to Mexico, and this is what a lot of this stuff is right here. I went to Mexico to photograph for a book on the Mayan ruin of Chichen Itza. Everything I shoot is handheld, so this is in pitch black. This is in the middle of the night, basically. So like this photo here, where did I shoot it? Obviously the white balance is terrible on that photo. I shot that at 1600, 50th of a second with a 1635. This was a Merida. Yeah, this is Merida for sure. So I'm just reviewing. I saw these musicians on the side. Just there's like a park in the middle. I think most Mexican towns have like these really, really cool parks in the middle. It's like the central square. So these guys were playing in front of this church. They just had their instruments and they were playing. So I'm just shooting pics. Very difficult because this is at night. And again, no flash, no nothing. I really like to fly by the seat of my pants, as you can tell. Now, obviously, the color balance on this is whacked a little bit. But it adds a little bit to the scene. So even if I go in and I just brighten his face just a little bit, okay? Again, this is why I really like this program. It's just like 2 seconds, it's done. I really hate sitting around fixing photos because I just get a feeling that I didn't do my job when I was there. So I really like this picture. It's really cool. So we'll just save that. And then I'll put a tag once I save it. That's why if you look at the bottom of the screen, I don't know if you can see it, but over here there's a little orange marker. And then next to it there's a little D, which means that I've developed it. And again, you know, anything's possible. I don't care if it's pitch black. I don't care what it is. Like, this shot's pretty cool. I love this arrow pointing at the musicians. It's almost like musicians for hire, you know? And when I shoot a picture like this, okay, I'm standing in the middle of the street, 1/50th of a second, 1600 ISO. I could have cranked it up more. I wanted a tight image. So I left it at 1600. And I'm underexposing it on purpose. Reason being, so I can keep the shutter speed somewhat manageable. So if I brighten this just a little bit and not kill the entire picture, now I have the meat that I'm looking for. Okay? And the picture still has that vibrant color in the background. I'm just going to, what I'm doing here is I'm lining up that arrow dead center of this image. Keeping those two guys in that other quadrant up in the top left. Okay. What I do is just my way of doing it, obviously. I mean, now, like a photo like this, okay, if you go back, I'm looking at this couple right here. So I'm experimenting and trying to get, and then I'm thinking maybe if I can leave the couple, but they're lost, you see? So I'm not too cool with this picture. Then, because obviously I was trying to include these kids walking the street, but then I see this guy right here, and he's walking. So I'm timing it so that he's directly under this. Now, if I come in tighter and I crop these two guys out of the picture, it'll be a far better picture, and it might just convey what I was looking for. Let's see. This is tough because, okay, I'm going to have to come in over here. Boom. Much cooler. See, when you make a crop like this, though, you have to be really, really aware of little things. What's the distance between the edge of this window and the edge of the frame? Okay, so let me take my own advice and bring it in a little bit so that these two things match up. Okay, not only that, it puts the arches, divides the space amongst four different openings. Okay, now I can go in and I can give these guys a little bit of love up here. And I can knock this down a little bit. Okay, and that's it. Again, I'm not looking for perfect photos. I'm just looking for really good moments. I'm adding a little contrast. That's what I'm doing with the curves here. So you guys are the first to see these photos. I hadn't even looked at these, which I'm rather embarrassed about. I don't want to remind myself about this. Here's some clowns, literally. This is really tough. I'm trying to have like a strong foreground element with this clown here, but the fact that I am working simply with ambient light, it makes it really difficult on things like this. And you can see the yellow hue to the entire photo because of the lights in the square. This, again, I'm walking around looking for stuff. I like this one. Okay, if you look, okay, so here's the first image that I took. I saw some guys coming. You can see underneath the feet, so I'm anticipating. And then I'm waiting for the legs to be open, so it shows that moment of motion, you see. Now, if the legs are just straight up and down, you could be standing. But if you notice, I took the first photo, this photo with the first step, then the next photo with the next step. So it's about having that gait to create a balance. Now, this photo here, obviously, I could do away with this car probably, and I could focus right here on this part. Okay, which this is like ham and cheese or whatever right here, the sign. That's why I was standing here. So if I just come in, and I really hate to make big crops, but sometimes you have to create the space that you're looking for. Now, you could easily leave the car in because the car has a cool dynamic, the lighting on the car, and the sky is very black, but let's see what that looks like. See, I actually don't like that as much. So if I just control Z, so this is the original picture. I'm just going to leave it. Even on something like this, you can see that I'm just looking at the space, but I'm really looking for people. You see the little guy over here? Then I see somebody else walking from behind me, and you'll notice he's in the frame right there. Sometimes you try shots, and no matter what you're going to do, it's not going to work. Okay, again, I can't stress this enough. It's all about the human element, man. Like this does nothing for me, absolutely nothing. But look what I did the next one. Okay, so I got my human element here. I'm not happy. This happened really quickly. Because I was focused on taking a shot up there and I didn't notice the guy walking below. So I took this shot really quickly and I kind of lobbed off the top of this fort, which I'm not particularly happy about, but I got it right there with another guy. Now, if I go forward, let's go back here. I really like this picture. So let me just fix this up a little bit. Okay, like for instance, see this? I'm going to just crop out the edge of that other building right there. Okay, much cleaner shot, much tighter. And I like it just the way it is because I like the pyramid shapes that the shadows are casting on this. I really like that. again, if you have questions, Todd's asking me, do I mess with skew? Nah, I don't usually mess with skew. I mean, I'm not an architectural photographer, and while I totally understand if you do, like for instance this right here, if I go back to this photo and I hit develop, let me control Z it. Hold on a second. So let me go back to the original frame. And this is to Todd Pacheco's asking me on Facebook if I ever mess with skew. Now, for instance, here's this photo that I was just playing with. And it's easy for me to go and change the vertical perspective so that the building looks straighter. You see? You can easily do that. Okay? Obviously, the crop becomes almost impossible the way it was because as it goes, things rise, right? And you can see how it changes the photograph. And while some of it is acceptable, like if I, like, say, let's say I did this and I included the top there, you know, I don't think that's too bad. Okay? But it's a preference. I'm not going to tell you, you know, oh, don't do skew, whatever, because honestly, if you have a tilt-shift lens, what do you think that does, right? But tilt-shift lenses are obviously used for architectural photography, and that's not what I am, but, you know, do as you please, obviously. I don't remember what these guys are, an ambulance or something. I don't know what this was. Very hard to take shots like this, pitch black. Like this, again, look for patterns, look for things that are happening, anticipate them, and then make it work. I saw these three girls walking down the street. And what I was really focused on was obviously the tower in the background. So it's a hard shot. I'm not sure I got what I wanted out of that. I mean, how do you come in this tight and not have the guy respond? And again, I just think that comes with experience and confidence that, you know, you belong there. And I think people pick up on that. I'm not sure what I was doing here. Oh, okay. Like these photos here, I was shooting without looking through the viewfinder at all. So like this photo here, which is pretty good, but honestly, it needs to be chopped up a little bit. I like this pavé stuff. I mean, I was 4 days in Mexico. 1, 2, 3, 4. I was 4 days in Mexico. And like I said, most of the time I was focused on Chichen Itza. So this right here was not much time. See, that hand coming up like that, it just makes for a much better picture. Like on something like this, because there's so much going on, I might just give it a little bit of vibrance so that all those different mags pop out. You can barely see it, but I think that'll do it. Yeah, Louise was asking me if I don't mind showing that dark sky. No, not at all. I mean, I want people to know that it's dark. It's in the middle of the night. I mean, and there's no way to get, there's just no way, unless you're using a graduated filter or something, to get like stars or something like that. And if you get stars or something like that with a graduated filter, everything else is going to be a blur. Again, I'm not an architectural photographer, so what I'm interested in is the human aspect of everything. So everything I do is handheld, and like whatever this is, street scenes. You notice it's very dark, and I like that. I really like that. It creates a dynamic. It puts me in a place. This was really nice. Like, again, notice, I was focused on those two individuals, and then the taxi blew by. But what I'm really looking for is something like that, a much cleaner image with no cars. And if you look, because she's in silhouette, it really makes the image. Because if she's facing another way, it just doesn't pop. Of course, people respond to you. You're not telling them anything. And look at this guy. He's giving me the thumbs up. Maybe he wanted me to buy one of those hats. I think I did buy a hat. Not necessarily from this guy. What else? Like, here's a good shot. This is really cool. So, at first, doesn't really hit you what's going on here, but that's the carriage guy. He's over there sitting there reading the paper. So I'm trying to maximize the entire thing. So let's see. I like this one. It just needs to be cropped in a little bit. But I want that sign that says Yucatan to stay in the photo, because that puts me in my place. Okay. On something like this, I might try like an auto white balance to see if it corrects much, which it kind of does. And then I might just brighten them up a little bit. That's cool. I don't mind dark photos. I think it adds something to the image. All right, so this is actually Chichen Itza right here. This is the hotel. There's a hotel on the backside. So I just walked in and I started taking photos. That one's cool right there. I don't know if you noticed, I'm just going to straighten it up a little bit. I don't know if you noticed how, I mean, I sound like a bloody ad, but one of the reasons I liked using AC/DC is because as a photojournalist, I don't have time to be sitting around waiting for photos to load. I like how quick it loads. Again, if you have questions, hit me up on Facebook or something. It's funny, like something as simple as where this fits inside this space. Okay, obviously much better right there. That's much better. Very cool. this is material that I shot for the book. That stuff is totally done. That's a good picture. Video? Huh. I should try playing one of these. I don't know if you're going to be able to see anything. Hold on. Let me try playing this. I shot some video with a Canon G9 or a G8. I'm not sure. I'm not sure the video is going to translate to this broadcast. Let's check it out. I have no idea what this is, by the way. And it might not work right because this is shot in high def. So let's see what happens. This is just me pointing the camera out the car while I'm driving. Oops. Okay, hold on a second. Like, I like to walk into homes, and this right here, hold on, I'm sure I can get this to play. Maybe I can use something else. Hold on a second. That's not what I want. Hold on one second. Okay, hold on. Okay, let me try something. Basically, I'm going to move it, and then I'm going to open it with media play.
So here's a typical Mayan home, and I got some friends, meus amigos, aquí. You want to go see them?
Okay.
Hola. ¿Cómo te llamas usted?
Teresa.
Teresa.
Sí.
¿Es tu niño?
Sí.
¿Cómo te llamas?
Lily.
Oh, nice. ¿Y usted?
Lily.
¿Lily?
Yuli.
Yuli. Muy bonito. That's a very cool house.
Hola.
¿Estás bien? Habla. Hi.
Hi.
These ladies are cooking. And look, they're gonna make it right now. Tortilla. Tortilla profesionalmente. Habla. Hi. Habla. Hi. Okay. Habla. Hi, Seti.
Hi, Seti.
I should note that what you're seeing is a video that I shot at just some random house. I happened to be walking on a street in a very small town. I don't even recall the name of the town. I know that I have it written somewhere. But I just saw some smoke from one of these typical Mayan homes that these folks live in. And I just walked in and I started shooting video.
Mejores tortillas en México, aquí.
These were really good tortillas, by the way. Really good.
Well, I got to give them some photos. It's a thatch home made out of sticks, and it's a Mayan tradition. This is the way they've been building homes forever. The man who built this is actually still lives here, so it's just beautiful. Habla hi. Habla hi.
So yeah, I mean, I don't know if that translated at all. I don't mean my Spanish. I mean, I don't know if you were able to see the video or if it was really choppy, which it probably was. But it's really cool. I mean, just walking in on these people's home, it's such a privilege. It really is. It's such a privilege to just be able to do it. I also did this. Let me see if I can show you guys this. And what I did was I had a small little camera attached to my camera strap. I think it was attached to my camera strap. Let's see if this will play. Yeah, so basically I have this attached to my camera strap and I just photographed whatever. And this camera was continuously... Now, what you're about to see here is, again, if you don't walk into the unknown, you'll never discover stuff like this. And basically what it was I ran into a family pulling a tooth from this young girl. So I'm shooting the pigs, and you're going to hear some screaming. I better put this volume down a little bit. And basically they were trying to, there she is right there. They were trying to rip her tooth out with a string or something. And this poor child is going ballistic. Now you can see my camera strap right here. I'm shooting photos. This video is just running. I think it was on my t-shirt. And I'll show you the photos in a second. She's obviously telling me that that's the kitchen. Now, let's see. I'm sure I have photos. Yeah, so here's the photos that I took on that day. This is inside these homes that I just ran in, that I just, you know, went into. And this all started because I saw a woman with a gun or something, so I followed her home. I mean, obviously, I have to edit this stuff down. I'm just going through it because I haven't really had a chance to look at this. Look, here's a cenote. Basically, it's like a cave with rainwater that it's accumulated. It's really beautiful. Oops. That's really cool. You can see the ray of light coming right in on this kid. It was really hot. And I really just wanted to jump in, to be quite honest with you. All right, thanks, Eric. Eric has just pointed out that the video streaming is okay, but I'm sure that's dropping frames big time. So here's the girl right here, actually, getting a tooth pull. If you can see, they're actually trying to use a string. I shot a lot of photos. This is like a huge family event. Look at this. This poor child was yelling at the top of her lungs. It was insane. There comes that string. Oh, man. Look at this. And there she is, toothless, getting a drink of water from her mom. You can see the blood. Oh, my Lord. again, I have no idea who these folks were. You know, I mean, I wish I could explain how I do this stuff, but I'm really driven to document regular people in their environment. And the only way to do that is just to walk in on people like this. And for the most part, I mean, they're really accommodating, and they really just accept me, which is kind of weird. I mean, I'm basically in their living room, you know? That's a really good picture. Let me just put the little wrapper on this. Yeah, I mean, I don't need to do anything else to this. I'm not sure. Actually, I can tell you exactly how long I spent with these folks. So I shot this photo. Okay, so I shot this photo at 3:13 p.m. Let's see what the last one was. 3:13 p.m. and I left their house at 3:19. So all this material was shot in 7 minutes. Okay? Hopefully that puts things in perspective. It's really hard shooting inside like this, and I really like the challenge. I like the challenge of being on the edge of total failure. And in a picture like this, I mean, granted, I'm using, in this case, I was using the 5D Mark IIs. Now I'm using the 5D Mark III. But even in an image like this, there's still plenty of meat. No pun intended here. But there's still plenty of stuff that you can pull out of this image. You see? Okay? So sometimes you need to shoot, you need to underexpose on purpose. Because if you try to expose properly, you're going to have a big mess, especially with those lit areas in the back. Like that woman walking through the door that you see back there, she would have been like overtaken by the light. Sometimes you just take photos for the hell of it. Like, for instance, obviously, so I took this at their home, and then I went to Chichen Itza. So I'm never going to use this. Never. I'm just taking the photos simply as a reference. I mean, it's the first time I was looking at it, so you know, I just want to take some shots. But it didn't take me long. I took, whatever, 10 shots, and now it's all, like I said, it's all about the people. So now I'm focusing on integrating, in this case, the pyramid with people. And that worked out really nice. This guy's trying to sell these tourists some statues or something, some masks. Just looking for interesting things. And this part right here was the stuff that you're seeing, anything that has to do with Chichen Itza was part of the book. So in this case, I was documenting the vendors, which a lot of people disagree that they shouldn't be there. And of course, the local economy basically demands that they're there because these people all live in the surrounding community. So you can see this guy is actually carving one of those masks. Like, see, that's a better photo because of the inclusion of the masks. And sometimes you just can't get the photo that you're looking for, like this. This cenote right here is part of the Chichen Itza thing, and I just couldn't get anything that really worked. I just couldn't get it. And you just give up. It's like, okay, I'm not going to get it, I'm not going to get it. That's it. Move on. It's funny, like on a shot like this, you can tell that this guy is Mayan descendant. You know, you can tell from the facial features. So, and he's selling these Mayan tapestries and whatever. This guy on the right was trying to sell these two kids these jaguar heads, there you go, that make a jaguar sound. I actually bought one for the hell of it. But again, it's all about the pyramid. It's all about the architectural site. So I'm trying to create images that are that can stand on their own. And you can see what's going on here. You can see this guy's teaching these two guys. And you can see in the context that he's in. And that's important. That's important. It's important to keep the big picture, no pun intended, in mind. And in this case, it's to document life around Chichen Itza. Okay? Not just the vendors, but the tourists, whatever. Again, what you're looking at right now, for some of you guys that it might just popped in, is the raw stuff like it came out of the camera, okay? Now, if you noticed earlier, I put this one into the piece that I shot, that I was reviewing earlier, some of the selection that I made for a gallery on Chichen Itza. It's all about the people, man. Anyway. This is really funny. So these two women here are taking the shot, right? They're just sitting there, and I'm just shooting the pictures. They have no clue. Watch what happens. This is funny. They're like, oh my God, there's a guy taking our picture. Like, these are really, it's really difficult to grab a good frame. You can see, again, pitch black. In this case, you can see some of the sky because the sun had set not that much earlier than when I took the photos. This guy was part of the book, and actually all these people were, those people were all part of the book project. I'll tell you, man, I want to be in this water right now. Oh. Well, actually, I wish it was warm, never mind the water. And to prove to you guys that this is the way they came out of the camera, let me show you. So here's one, here's the next, and now I'm walking, and look, misfire. That's the bottom of my foot right there. Looking into the mouth of the dragon. Again, more misfires, because I like hang, my cameras obviously hang one on each side, and I like to point the lenses inward, and the reason for that is you don't want your lenses getting clipped by poles or walls or whatever, and what happens is sometimes the shutter, like here's another one, and another one hits the side, my belt or something, and it fires. Look, you can see more and more and more firing at the ground. There it is. See, like, you can start, and you can see somebody moving across. Now, this guy right here, this vendor, is really screwing this picture up. So I'm staying with it, and then he disappeared, and there's the photo that I'm looking for. This part right here, this is, I forgot what these things are called. If anybody knows, please inform. But this is, like, a really important ruin. This is in Chichen Itza, obviously, but this statue is quite important, and there's just a symmetry about this that that really works in this particular photo. Now, like, for instance, I see this guy with glasses. Now, you can actually see me right there. Here I am. Okay? So then I'm adjusting my position, and there it is. I'm waiting for somebody to walk by to create something that's a little more interesting. In this case, some tourists.
Eat the tourist.
Wow, man, I still got quite a few viewers. Well, I'm impressed that I've managed to hang on to you guys this long. Look, there's a self-portrait right there. I was probably sweaty and really tired right about now. Hold on, somebody's emailing me or something. Hold on 1 second. All right. I guess some folks are subscribing. I didn't even realize you could subscribe to this. Which is real. I guess you can subscribe to this. If you can, that'd be great. I plan on doing these whenever I get a chance. Now you can see it, the shadow of the serpent's back. There's the serpent right here. It's starting to grow as the sun slowly descends. You can see the ridges on the snake's back starting to be formed by the step pyramid, which is the whole purpose of the event. But it's really, really hard to shoot that. It really is. It's really hard to shoot that. Again, I'm interested in the people. See? So in this case, I got the serpent's back, I got the serpent, and I got people in the photo. This guy is obviously explaining to this woman why they're there to begin with. Whoa. That's pretty cool. So you saw this shot earlier. I had moved this one over to the other side. But you can see that I shot and I was waiting for the guy to just be in the right position, and then boom, I nailed it right there. I got a couple of more, but it did nowhere near as good as this picture. Because of the cell phones and the way his arms are, the way that he's in profile, it really worked out well. Well, guys, I'm totally exhausted. I've been up since 4 o'clock in the morning. I had to bring one of my photographer friends to the airport. He went to go visit his kids down in Florida. So it's been a long day. And, you know, I wouldn't trade it for anything else. But So I started at 4 o'clock in the morning. I dropped them off in Providence. If some of you guys that live around here know, there was snowing early this morning. So it was kind of like a weird ride. And then I had the assignment. Not the assignment. I had, let me see. I went to the paper, the Standard Times. And I shot some cool shots, obviously. I also shot, I don't know if you guys saw my photo of the day, but if you didn't, I'm going to show it to you now. Let's see. So there's my website. If you click singles, this, February. Oh, look, I haven't updated it yet. I mean, this was yesterday's photo of the day. Hold on a second. I'll have to send the calendar over, so let me just put it today's. So this today's the truant gang of geese walking on thin ice there. So every day is a challenge. Every day is interesting, obviously. So let me just – so there's my website right here. My website, I did the whole thing from scratch. So here it is. I've got to upload the February calendar because I hadn't uploaded it yet. Okay, there it is. So I'm going to publish that so that the links can all start working. So that's going. And hopefully when I hit this, I see Eric has said something. I think he liked it. That's cool, man. So now that it's updated, a little trick for you guys who are not like computer gods or anything, but like if I had to refresh this page, you can see the new pictures here. However, if you want a fresh refresh, because sometimes you might hear refresh, and if the page is cached in the memory of your computer, you're not actually going to see anything. And the way to do that is hit the refresh key and hold the shift key on your keyboard at the same time. So if you do that, it's a clean refresh, and it forces the browser to load the entire page, all the elements in it, regardless of what it thinks it knows. Okay? So like this page here, I'm going to do a refresh, and if I hit this, see, now it goes. Even though, originally when I tried it 5 minutes ago, it hadn't worked. So this month has been rather interesting so far. So this is my first picture of the year. I don't know what we can see here. Okay. So February 4th. Ken Bizarro is actually, we're friends on Facebook as well, and I found out that he was working on this, so I asked to come over, and he was working on it. This shot's pretty cool. Driving around, I saw this woman training this horse. So I just sat there, and basically they were just doing concentric circles around. She was just, you know, letting the horse run. And I got it right when it was in midair as it galloping by. This is the day before the storm. And if you, those of you who live up here, you know how much hype there was about this storm. And justifiably so, because we ended up getting quite a bit of snow. So what I was thinking is, okay, who's preparing for what? Who's doing what? So basically, I went to the Dartmouth Department of Public Works, and I just started snooping around. They all know me, so it was all good, you know. And I saw this mountain of salt, and I think the mountain basically stood for the enormity of the storm we were going to hit. So I just sat there, and then this guy came in, and he wanted to check how much more he needed to order, because you can see that they have already scraped some off where he's standing. So that made for a really good picture. This is the day of the storm. I shot this at 751. I shot a set of three photos of these guys. This one and the other one, the AP picked them up. And especially the other one that you don't see here. It's a guy with a chainsaw. That photo ran everywhere. I actually, one of my friends, her father's in the Philippines, and that ran in the Manila Times or whatever. So it's really cool to get a global outreach on things. Now, obviously, I shot the storm. On Saturday, I shot some photos, but I had to speak at the NEAPNEA convention up in Boston. So I haven't had a chance to compile the material that I shot on Saturday morning. I didn't even have a chance. So this was actually the day after the storm. So this is Monday. And when I saw this girl bailing out this boat, it was just, I couldn't have written a better, you know, a photo that basically showed. I mean, it's literal interpretation, really. It's bailing out after the storm. But then earlier, if you look down at the bottom here, I had shot this photo from the top of the Unitarian Church. And this photo right here, I actually shot that with my cell phone. I shot that using the Samsung Galaxy Note 2, which has an automatic panorama thing. So I just hung out of the tower, and then I just scrolled my camera, the phone across, and then it did the panorama, and it came out pretty good. Obviously, this was yesterday, day before Valentine's Day. And I mean, that's another thing. I mean, if you know and you're working for a newspaper and you know that there's a holiday or something, why not go out there and see what people are doing, especially on Valentine's Day? You know people are going to be buying chocolates or whatever. And I just sat there. This woman had no idea. No idea that she had her photo taken until I went to her and I asked her name. She's like, who are you? But, you know, it turned out well. And that's today's photo. But you guys know, I mean, I keep the daily. And basically it's a way to keep you motivated. If you know that you have a reason to not just give it to the paper, but it forces you to look for the photographs. It forces you to really say, okay, let me get this right. Whatever I'm going to call my photo of the day is going to probably stay there for a very long time, and that's going to represent me. So if every day all you have is like a junky photo of something, well, that's what it's going to come down to. So every day you have to force yourself to try a little harder. And I found these guys cutting these connecting pieces of metal here. So he's cutting this with a cutter, and I just hung out. And how did I get the spark effect? Remember I told you I don't carry a tripod or anything? There was a 3-foot step ladder, and I just put my camera on top of it, and I just shot the photos. Yeah, it was pretty cold. For those of you guys that live in Europe, this was 14 Fahrenheit. So you make the conversion. It was minus 20 centigrade or something like that. It gets really cold up here. The lucky thing is Massachusetts actually has four seasons. It really gets hot in the summer, sometimes 100 degrees, and it really gets cold in the winter. So I can't complain. I really can't. I shot this at Mass Maritime Academy. Obviously, you guys can just go to my website and see this. And for the most part, you guys probably already have. But this project is about the cadets from Mass Maritime, which is it's a Merchant Marine Academy. Okay, so these kids are going to be merchant mariners. And they were taking off and going to 50 days they're going to be away from home, right? So I got there really early, and basically what I did was, and this is an advice that I'm going to give to some of you guys, is if you're doing a piece and you really don't know, I mean, you know what the general story is, but you don't know how to, you have to come up with a plan is the moral of the story, okay? And in this case, I attached myself to this youngster right here. Okay, so by telling the story through his eyes, but here's a big but, not excluding the rest of what is happening around me, then my odds are much higher that I'm going to get a piece that not only has a general outlook, but also has a specific outlook, so that the story is told in this case through this guy's eyes, but with a general view of the entire event as well. So while I'm focusing on him, I am doing much more than that, right? I am also focusing on the event. So I'm not getting completely captivated just simply by one guy, and in this case, his girlfriend. I'm trying to get everything. I'm trying to really capture the event. But if I can anchor it, if I can anchor the entire piece on a single family, it just makes it that much stronger. Now, these folks are not related. Now, there's my subject again. And there he is again. And again. So you can see that I'm focusing on him, but I'm also thinking of the entire event, okay? That was too funny. Don't puke too much, Jillian. I mean, again, don't get carried away focusing on one specific thing. This girl had nothing to do with my subject. I have no idea what this girl's name is. It's just the perfect face. It's just the perfect representation of the emotions that happen between these kids leaving and their families being left behind. Now, if you guys have any questions, I mean, I'm going to wrap this up pretty soon because, like I said, I started at 4 o'clock in the morning today, and it's 9 p.m. now. I'm getting really tired, but if you have any questions, let's see, somebody else commented on something. Yeah, Eric Brooklyn has quickly mentioned here that it will be 48 Fahrenheit tomorrow, which is incredibly balmy at this time of year, so I'm definitely looking forward to that. The material I was showing you earlier, obviously, I haven't even had a chance to do anything with it. I haven't put it up here, the Mexico thing. I haven't done any of that. So look for a couple of pieces that I'm going to put up here from Mexico, specifically from the Yucatan Peninsula, because that's what I was focusing on. I mean, I know you guys have all seen this material. I actually got an email from a fellow photographer who actually had seen my work. I'm not sure which one the Harvard Magazine has up on their website, but here's what the Harvard Magazine cover looks like. So this is the November issue of Harvard Magazine. That's a photo that I shot of a youngster who him and his friends back here, basically they raid, it's right here, basically they raid the trains looking for bottles, and these people basically live on the tracks. They live right in the train station. This is in Jaipur. There's Badal, that was his name. And then they gamble for it, and then they fight. So they play cards. You can notice that this guy back here, he's won some bottles. See, he's stuffing some bottles inside his bag. Now this kid obviously lost the bottles, and this guy wants his bottles. And then the worst part is, for the most part, they're all addicted to sniffing glue. So it's a really tragic, let me put it that way, really tragic situation. There's Badal jumping on the train, raiding the train. And I mean, it's important. I mean, obviously, you can see from my work that I really like to shoot wide with a wide angle. I like to be really close to my subjects. I like to be in the space. But it's important for a client to have a variety of work. Different lenses, different perspectives, different ways of seeing the environment or the story that you're trying to capture. And when you just give them this, every photo has the same feel, then the client and the magazine, the publication, whatever, is it has a harder time. You have a harder time selling the material because they don't have that ability to really use it in as a double truck or as a cover. So it's important to give them a variety of material to work with. I mean, these people literally live. This isn't Jaipur, India. They live right on the train station, and it is what it is. I mean, it's hard for me to explain the emotions that I feel when I'm shooting these kind of pictures. Because, I mean, it's easy for someone to, like, for instance, accuse me of taking advantage of these people. But at the end of the day, when I'm shooting pictures like this, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to highlight a part of the world that the West, us in the United States, are not really aware of. And I want them to understand that they're not, you know, not everyone has, if you're poor, assisted living. Not everybody has a lot of the things that we take for granted. And it's, you know, it's emotional sometimes to take photos like this, you know? I mean, the train, sleeper class, and there are these people sleeping in the middle of the train station. It's an emotional process. I mean, don't think for a second that I'm not impacted by the things that I'm looking at. And I think that gives you, ultimately, that gives you strength. But, you know, there is a caste system going on in India. There is the people who have a little bit of money look down on the people that have no money. The people that have no money look down on the people that have no money and no clothing or anything else. So it's really a tragic situation. Like, you can tell this woman is so looking down on this kid. If she could, she'd probably kick him. And I saw it happening. So it's, you know, you try to do your best. You try to do your best to show the stories, to tell the stories, and ultimately you hope you come back with a portfolio of work that does the environment that you set out to photograph some justice, and that's what I always try to do. And I don't want to depress you guys, it's late. So let me hold on a second. Chat by text with people in the hangout. Okay, how do I do that? Oh, okay. Let me see. If you guys are watching this on Google Plus, by the way, which is what I'm actually using, Google Plus. I'm using Google Plus, and I'm broadcasting this on YouTube Live as well. But if you're on Google Plus, it turns out I can just write stuff like, hi, and you can respond or you can ask me questions on the right side. And actually, I believe if you're on Google Plus Hangout, you could actually join this conversation with your own video. So what am I working on right now? I'll tell you what I'm working on right now. As far as beyond the obviously daily assignments that I have. I'm putting in a request to go to Tanzania with a stop in Dubai, hopefully, to document some students and teachers who are, doctors, local doctors, who are creating these impromptu, basically they're visiting different villages in Tanzania and trying to give these people assistance. So hopefully I can get that, the funding for that, and that will be in July. And if I stop in Dubai, I basically just want to climb the tallest building, the Burj Khalifa. And, of course, I'm interested in Dubai. I mean, if it was up to me, there would be a lot of countries in the Middle East that I'm really, really interested in. Obviously, I've been to Egypt a couple of times, but that's not technically Middle East. That's near Middle East or something like that. So yeah, if you get a chance, check out this work. the easiest way to see the India stuff is if you click foreign and then India like this, or if you click out there and then Harvard Magazine, and then a bunch of different galleries are here. Or if you want to discover even more that I didn't even put there, is you go like this, January 2012, and then if you notice, look, little hidden Easter eggs in computer talk. If you click, for instance, on this, you're going to see a slideshow that I have no other link to, just random images of Mumbai, okay? Like, I bet you guys have never seen these because there's no link in my website to any of this material. So this stuff is material I shot in Mumbai, which I haven't even turned around and given the agency yet, which I will. This right here is actually a laundromat, except there's no machines, as you can tell. It's all done by hand in the middle of Mumbai. So you can do that. If you go to January 2012, you can find little Easter egg slideshows that I have no other links to, which I should because this material is pretty good. And I did these basically on the fly. So what do I mean by that? Is I shot the photos, and that same day I would create the slideshow and post it on my website. Again, you've probably never seen these images because I have no link to them, which I don't know why I did that, but I did. And I think one of the reasons that I haven't linked them to, for instance, the foreign page on my site is because it doesn't have an introductory to it. So it doesn't have that first page that will give you a context of what it is that you're looking at. And until I create that, I don't think I'm going to put a link to them yet. But I have a whole series of slideshows that I did that are hidden as Easter eggs. And that's lingo, tech lingo for hidden things. So, again, this is Mumbai. I shot these just random pictures of me trying to document life in Mumbai. Just, you know, walking around miles on end. And look, see, this photo didn't come out right. Just hours on end of walking around just by myself documenting life in Mumbai. And Mumbai is like an insane city, man. Just completely insane. It's like so gigantic. It took me 3 hours, a taxi ride from one side to the other. I'm not even making that up. See, like those images I have to fix. But it took me 3 hours to go from one side of Mumbai to the other, which is completely insane. There's a lot of Hindu temples, obviously. But there's also a lot of Muslim neighborhoods, which I was rather surprised, and I focused a lot on that. If you go to the foreign and you look for Cheetah Camp, that was a Muslim slum, actually. So, I mean, if you don't walk and you don't go where you're not supposed to be, then you're not going to get much. You're going to get what everybody else gets, and that's not what I'm interested in. All right, so that goes back to the beginning. Let's see what else I did. So the next day, all right, so Cheetah Camp, you can see that. So that's not an Easter egg per se. This one is actually the first one on my website, right? Okay, hold on a second. Somebody else said something. Luiz, I just want to thank you from being here from Portugal and listening to my shenanigans. I hope you enjoyed it. And one of these days we'll meet when I go to Portugal. Does that sound good? Thank you, Luiz. This is a fishing village. That's also linked. Let's see. What else? Okay, so here's a piece that I did. There's no link as well. This is another little hidden thing. I did a piece on a train ride. So basically, this entire piece that you're seeing here is my fascination with riding trains with people. And Indian trains are like no other type of train. It's hard to explain. Well, I guess that's why I photographed it. So I'm just fascinated by this kind of stuff. And I took this train to go to the Taj Mahal, right? This is the funny part of this, is I took this train from Delhi, from Jaipur. I don't even remember anymore. I took so many trains and planes, I don't even know. But anyway, the moral of the story is I took this train to eventually get to the Taj Mahal, and I did. I went to the Taj Mahal, but you're not going to see any photos of the Taj Mahal on my website because I'm really not that interested in the Taj Mahal. I'm interested in the people. And the Taj Mahal, by the way, is an absolute masterpiece. It's infinitely more beautiful than any photo could ever give it credit for. But anyway, I'm just interested in something as simple as a train ride. I spent my entire, a couple of hours just walking back and forth, jumping into people's cabins. And again, I could not communicate with 90% of these people because they speak Hindi. So, I don't know. I just do it because I really feel like I need to tell these stories. And that's what it's about. Again, there's no link to this, so if you ever want to look at this again, you'll have to go to Daily Photo Journal, Daily Photo January, and look for the Indian flags and just start clicking flags to see which ones you haven't found yet. Because I did these slideshows in India while I was in India, and then I uploaded it to my server at home, and then I created links remotely from there, and it worked out pretty well because I was able to do this. And then at the end of the day, I would tweet this, and I would say, "Hey, there's a piece I shot today, taking a train to whatever." Okay, so that's the end of that one. Let's see what else I shot. Look, there's another piece that there's no links to. Basically, I found myself in there's like a huge boom of construction in India. And the problem is all this construction is leaving a lot of kids homeless because their parents spend their entire day constructing. So these places have popped up, these schools for these abandoned kids. And I spent some time at one of these huge construction sites. This is in Delhi, actually the outskirts of Delhi. I'm not sure what the actual neighborhood name is. So again, no link to this anywhere on my website. You really have to go dig for it to find it, which eventually I will put a link so that it's easier to navigate and easier to find. But the moral of this piece is the kids that are getting left behind with this huge expansion that India is going through right now. I haven't looked at these since the day that I shot them. I really haven't because, I mean, obviously I have so much stuff that I'm working on. After I created these slideshows, what I'm doing now is I'm sending these pieces to the agency, and hopefully we can find some clients for the stuff, and there might just be one photo that gets sold to a Newsweek or something or Time or whatever, but I have to basically assemble these as packages and then email them up. But they're fully captioned because when I work on the site, I caption the material the same day so that it's fresh in my mind. If I can, I actually edit it the same day, with the exception being that Mexico material that I was showing you guys earlier. I did not caption that stuff at all because that stuff was not the reason I was there to begin with. I was there to shoot a book on the Mayan ruin of Chichen Itza. So in this case, I put this material together, I captioned it, I edited it right there in India. I don't want to come back and be sitting around for days on end editing stuff. I really don't. I want them, and not only that, Harvard Magazine's not going to be too happy if they wait a month to get their photos. So get the stuff, get it run, get it done. You come back, boom, you send 50 photos to the client. They're happy because now they expected you maybe to take, I don't know, a couple of weeks, and now they can already start their part of the editing process, which is laying out pages, putting text, whatever. So it's important to, you know, to get it done, and especially with captions, because I really, really like to caption my material right away. It's important. If you don't know what the heck you're looking at, a month later, then how can you possibly put a caption that's relevant? So these are the towns that these people, that the workers live in. And of course, these are the kids that are left behind because their parents are working day and night, literally day and night on these buildings. So that's another little hidden slideshow. Oh, look, there's a picture of me right there. I just set my camera on the ground and hit the timer button. So there's a lot of material. Even on something like this, if you look at it, they're all different, they're all dynamic, they're all different vantage points, different looks, different feels. Even on something that I spent no more than half an hour at inside this place. This is the moms, by the way. They just come by to check up on the kids. So this is the beginning again. What else did I do? What is this? Okay, this is the train kids, which I showed you guys a little while ago. Look, here's another one. This is basically random material in Jaipur. So these are random shots that I shot in Jaipur, India, with no particular story. I just walked around shooting photos and just whatever. I mean, everything is interesting, right? Everything. There isn't anything that's not interesting. And that's the beauty of being a photojournalist. It's like, the world is just there to be discovered, man. That's what it's all about. Now, this right here that you're seeing is a little village that's been created for what they call them, the elephant people. There's like a huge palace in Jaipur, and those guys have these elephants, and they take tourists and stuff up and down the walls of this palace thing. These are just street scenes from Jaipur. Different material, different lenses. This is another elephant guy living in another part of Jaipur. And they really live with their elephants. I mean, they're elephants. They're tied down, obviously, but they live right above them. Their homes are right above it. I found a school, so I walked in on their English class, ironically. It's just a different, you know, it's just different, man. I don't know. It's not right or wrong. It's just different, and that's what I love to discover. The architecture there is really beautiful, man. Oh, look, I was there the day that everybody was flying kites. Those little dots are all kites. And I had that kite picture. I shot that out of a moving car, by the way. I climbed up to the top of this mountain. I almost killed myself a couple of times. This is the elephant, folks. It's funny because, again, I hadn't looked at these photographs since pretty much the day I took them. And it's cool to go back and you know, be critical of your own work and look at it and say, okay, I could have done better or whatever. These monkeys are just running wild. I almost got attacked by that one. That one didn't like me for some reason. There's a holy man. And, you know, I mean, if you read guidebooks, man, every time you go, you know, you travel somewhere, you read a guidebook and it says, oh, don't take photos of this, don't take photos of that. I mean, but, you know, as a journalist, my job is to take photos of everything. So that's just the way it is. If you guys, if anybody here who's watching has seen Slumdog Millionaire, this is the slum, the Darby slum that movie is based on. And this slum dude is like, honestly, it's got its own ecosystem. It probably has its own atmosphere, for God's sake. I mean, this thing is huge. It's like, I think, the second largest slum in the entire world. And it's really fascinating, man. I mean, there's stores, there's everything. There's absolutely everything in this place. So I spent some time there. But I think there's a link to this, so I'll spare you guys this one. Let me see if I put any other ones. No. See, look, I come back from India, I start shooting pictures again. So I came back on a Saturday. I was back at work on Tuesday. Actually, I was back on work on Monday. I just didn't take anything that I really liked. So, like, every day is a challenge, you know? Every day is a challenge, and that's the beauty of the business. Some days you drive around aimlessly, and you get nothing, absolutely nothing, right? You might drive around for 4 hours, and you get nothing. And then all of a sudden, you get this killer shot, right? And that happens. And I'll give you an example before I go, because I'm really beat up. But hold on, somebody else has made some comments. Eric, thanks for posting the link to this, by the way, Eric. I really appreciate that. This is Eric Berkland, who's the president of the Whaling City Camera Club. He's a friend of mine. And the Camera Club always asks me to speak at their club once a year, and I really, really enjoy the event. I mean, anything I can do to motivate people to think about their camera as a tool of expression, I will go to whatever, man. I'll go to the end of the world to talk to people about that. So let me show you. Sometimes you drive around aimlessly, and then all of a sudden, you know, you hear something, right? Or somebody says, oh, my God, there's been a fire or whatever. Or you get a call. And that's what happened here. And there was a fire. And I'd been working since 8 o'clock in the morning, and nothing was going on. And all of a sudden, we'd heard there was a fire. This was on December 5th. So I responded. I went there. The flames were still going. But I really care about the human condition. It's not about flames. It really isn't. It's about the impact that the flames have on the humans. So I shot this picture. And it's probably one of my favorite photos that I took all year. It is my best photo that I took all year because it has all the elements that make for a real powerful image. As a matter of fact, this image won first place in Spot News in the Northern Short Course for the National Press Photographers Association, which is a pretty relatively big deal. And, you know, if you don't take the time and to just hang out, and look to see. Now, the relevance of this photo is that woman, that's her son, who's a firefighter, and now all of a sudden he's fighting the fire at his own business, basically. That's his parents' business that burnt down. So that's the power of the image. But if I hadn't left, like the rest of the media, this image would have never grabbed it. I would have never had it because everybody's gone. And I just felt that there was a story to be told, and it wasn't about flames. It wasn't about anything. It's all about the human condition. And I had plenty of other photos. And all of a sudden, this happened, and I was ready for it, and I took the shot. And the best part is they had no idea I took the photo, okay, because I actually asked for their name because I didn't want to disturb their moment by asking their name after I took the photo. I let them be, and then I went off to the side. There was a group of people, and I asked for their names. They told me. And then I ran into this firefighter again last month, so a month later. And he basically thanked me for the photograph. And, you know, that's the highest compliment anybody can give you is when you're covering, like, one of the, you know, the most difficult parts of, you know, their lives, and there's somebody thanking you. I mean, what else can you possibly say, right? What else can you possibly say? I'm speechless, you know? So yeah, things like that happen where you think your day is going nowhere and all of a sudden there it is. As a matter of fact, you know, one of the pieces of advice that I've listened to for the last 12 years was there was a Boston Herald photographer that I became friends with who was stringing at the Standard Times for a while there. And he said, you know, there's a Pulitzer Prize winning photograph happening every day, everywhere. That's the key. Everywhere. It's just, you need to be there. But if you're there, you need to be able to capture. And that only comes in a shot like this completely by instinct. And your automatic takes over. You don't have time for anything. You don't have time for checking if the exposure's right. Nothing. It's completely by instinct. And those are always the best photos. Always the best photos. So I'm going to let you guys go now because I want to go night-night. Let me know if you enjoyed this. Obviously, I'm going to... For those watching on YouTube who have no idea who I am, that's who I am. That's my name. If you click bio contact, there's my email address right there. If you have any questions or comments, if you hate my work, that's cool. Let me know. If you like it, let me know as well, obviously. Thank you so much, guys, for watching. I plan on doing this more, but I'm not going to do it unless you guys tell me it worked, because I'm not sure the connection was right. I'm not sure that the video was fluid. I have no idea. I'm on this side of the camera. I'd love to know what you guys saw on that side. So with that said, thank you, good night, and stay shooting. Ciao.